Well, let me start with a broader point. I think both Angela and I have emphasized that the prospect for a military solution to this problem has always been low. Russia obviously has a extraordinarily powerful military, and you know, given the length of the Russian border with Ukraine, given the history between Russia and Ukraine, expecting that if Russia is determined that Ukraine can fully rebuff a Russian army has always been unlikely. But what we have said is that the international community, working together, can ratchet up the costs for the violation of the core principle of sovereignty and territorial integrity. And that's exactly what we've done. And Russia has paid a significant cost for its actions, first in Crimea and now in eastern Ukraine. It has not yet dissuaded Mr. Putin from following the course that he is on. But it has created a measurable negative impact on the Russian economy, and that will continue. My hope is that through these diplomatic efforts, those costs have become high enough that Mr. Putin's preferred option is for a diplomatic resolution. And I won't prejudge whether or not they'll be successful. If they are successful, it will be in part because of the extraordinary patience and effort of Chancellor Merkel and her team. If they are not, then we will continue to raise those costs. And we will not relent in that. And one of the things I'm very encouraged about is the degree to which we've been able to maintain U.S. European unity on this issue. Now, it is true that if, in fact, diplomacy fails, what I've asked my team to do is to look at all options. What other means can we put in place to change Mr. Putin's calculus? And the possibility of lethal defensive weapons is one of those options that's being examined. But I have not made a decision about that yet. I've consulted with not just Angela, but will be consulting with other allies about this issue. It's not based on the idea that Ukraine could defeat a Russian army that was determined. It is rather to see whether or not there are additional things we can do to help Ukraine bolster its defenses in the face of separatist aggression. But I want to emphasize that a decision has not yet been made. One of the bigger issues that we're also concerned with, though, is making sure that the Ukrainian economy is functioning and that President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk can continue with the reform efforts that they've made. And I'm glad to see that because of our cooperation and our efforts, we're starting to see a package come together with the IMF, with the European Union and others that can help bolster the European economy so that they have the space to continue to execute some of the reforms and anti-corruption measures that they've made. One of the most important things we can do for Ukraine is help them succeed economically, because that's how people on the ground feel this change, this transformation inside of Ukraine. If that experiment fails, then the larger project of an independent Ukraine will fail. And so we're going to do everything we can to help bolster that. But there is no doubt that if, in fact, diplomacy fails this week, there's going to continue to be a strong, unified response between the United States and Europe. That's not going to change. There may be some areas where there are tactical disagreements. There may not be. But the broad principle that we have to stand up for not just Ukraine, but the principle of territorial integrity and sovereignty is one where we are completely unified.
That's great. Okay, dafür stehen wir weiterhin ein.
Der französische Präsident und ich haben uns entschlossen, nochmal einen Versuch zu unternehmen, diplomatisch voranzukommen. Wir haben das Minsk-Abkommen umgesetzt worden.
We have the Minsk Agreement. The Minsk Agreement has never been implemented. Quite the contrary is true. The situation has actually worsened on the ground. So now there is a possibility to try and bring about a ceasefire
Bedingungen, and to also create conditions
that are then in place where you have not every day civilians dying, civil victims that fall prey to this. And I'm absolutely confident that we will do this together. I myself actually would not be able to live with not having made this attempt. So there is anything but an assured success in all of this. I have to be very clear about this. But if at a certain point in time one has to say that a success is not possible, even if one puts every effort into it, then the United States and Europe have to sit together and try and explore further possibilities what one can do. Just let me point out here that foreign ministers of the European Union last week already tasked the Commission to think about further possible sanctions. On the issue of what is effective and what not, I'm somewhat surprised sometimes. Let me mention Iran. For a fairly long period of time, we have had sanctions in place there. People don't seem to question them. And I think they have been fairly successful if we look at the current state of affairs, what with the negotiations on the nuclear program. So I think, in parallel, I think it was a very good thing to put some cost on to the Russians through these sanctions that we agreed on, because we see also that Russia seems to be influenced by this. And this is why I am 100% behind these decisions. As to the export of arms, I have given you my opinion, but you may rest assured that no matter what we decide, the alliance between the United States and Europe will continue to stand, will continue to be solid, even though on certain issues we may not always agree. But this partnership, be it on Ukraine and Russia, be it on combating terrorism, on the international stage, be it on other issues, is a partnership that has stood the test of time and that is, I mean, in Europe, we're very close, but this transatlantic partnership for Germany and for Europe is indispensable, and this will remain so, and I can say this also on behalf of my colleagues in the European Union.
Frau Dutz, ja, ich muss ja selber aufrufen.
Sorry, I have to call you myself, Frau Dutz.
From DPA, the German Press Agency.
President, you said that you have not yet made a decision as to whether weapons ought to be delivered to Ukraine. What would be your red line? What would be the red line that needs to be crossed for you to decide an armament of the Ukrainian army?
And
what do you think will this hold by way of a promise? Because the Chancellor said it will make matters worse. And what can the Nobel laureate Obama do more to defuse this conflict? And Madam Chancellor, President Putin today demanded yet again that the government in Kiev negotiate directly with the separatists. When do you think the right moment has come to do this? And with looking at all of the big issues that you discussed, this breach of confidence due to the NSA affair of the U.S.-German relations, has that played a role today?
Do you want to go first on that?
Ich kann gerne beginnen.
I can gladly start.
Die Frage der Einschätzung bestimmter
the question
Maßnahmen,
as to how one assesses the effectiveness of certain measures has been actually dealt with. The President has not yet made a decision. As he said, what's important for me is that we stand very closely together on the question of a new, renewed diplomatic effort. We keep each other informed, we are in close touch, and nobody wishes more for a success than the two of us who stand here side by side. But this would also mean not only having a ceasefire in place, but to also, over and above that, having certain rules in place. And you said the Russian president himself thinks there ought to be direct contracts. Let me just point out to you, these direct contracts already exist through the trilateral contact group with representatives from Donetsk and Luhansk. And the problem of the last few days and the problem of the last meetings actually was rather more than that. There was not really that much of an end result, if they met at all, or if representatives from Donetsk and Luhansk were there at all. Sometimes they didn't even arrive. And this was, after all, for me, the core of the Minsk agreement, that there are local elections in accordance with the Ukrainian constitution, and that the outcome of that is that you have representatives, authorities that can speak for those regions, and the Ukrainian president has paved the way for this, to giving certain specific status to the oblasts of Lugansk and Donetsk. And these elections are an essential point that will then enable us to say, well, maybe now there can be contacts even without a trilateral group. And this is, after all, on the agenda of the many talks that we need to make. But I can very well understand the Ukrainian side that on the territory that they consider to be part of their territory, and that anything else would violate their territorial integrity, that they want to actually see that elections take place there. And that has also been stated by President Putin that he wishes to see those elections happening there. Now, on the NSA issue, I think there are still different assessments on individual issues there. But if we look at the sheer dimension of the terrorist threat, we are more than aware of the fact that we need to work together very closely. And I, as German Chancellor, want to state here very clearly that the institutions of the United States of America have provided us, or still continue to provide us, with a lot of very significant, very important information that also ensure our security. And we don't want to do without this. There are other possibilities through the cyber dialogue, for example, to continue to talk about the sort of protection of privacy versus data protection and so on, and security. But this was basically, combating terrorism was basically
with respect to providing lethal weapons to Ukraine. It's important to point out that we have been providing assistance to the Ukrainian military generally. That's been part of a long-standing relationship between NATO and Ukraine. And our goal has not been for Ukraine to be equipped to carry on offensive operations, but to simply defend itself. And President Poroshenko has been very clear. He's not interested in escalating violence. He is interested in having his country, his country's boundaries respected by its neighbor. So there's not going to be any specific point at which I say, clearly lethal defensive weapons would be appropriate here. It is our ongoing analysis of what can we do to dissuade Russia from encroaching further and further on Ukrainian territory. Our hope is that that's done through diplomatic means. And I just want to emphasize here once again, for the benefit not just of the American people, but for the German people, we are not looking for Russia to fail. We are not looking for Russia to be surrounded and contained and weakened. Our preference is for a strong, prosperous, vibrant, confident Russia that can be a partner with us on a whole host of global challenges. And that's how I operated throughout my first term in office. Unfortunately, Russia has made a decision that I think is bad for them strategically, bad for Europe, bad for the world. And in the face of this aggression and these bad decisions, we can't simply try to talk them out of it. We have to show them that the world is unified in imposing a cost for this aggression. And that's what we're going to continue to do.